お話します。日立っていうのはやっぱりものづくり企業をずっとやっているんですね。それはどういうことかというと、製品を作って提供するという時代がありました。これ今も続けていますけど、それと、デジタルの時代になった時にお客様の課題が何で、課題を聞きながらデジタルで、ソリューションを提供するという、お客様と競争する、顧客コクリエーション、競争型のビジネスでやってきたんですね。これまで製品を提供する、あるいは顧客と競争しながらソリューションを提供するという仕事をやってきました。
Let me start with addressing this question. Hitachi has been a company that has been focused on manufacturing and providing the product to the customers. But now we are increasingly using digitalization to provide digital solutions to the challenges facing the customers today. We are promoting this in the form of co-creation with the customer.
例えばお客様、工場を経営しているお客様であれば、どういうふうにすれば品質が改善されるのか、あるいはどういうふうにすればもっとリードタイム、短い時間で物が作れるのか、まあ、そういう課題を聞いて、それをお客様と一緒に解決すると、まあ、それがお客様とのコークリエーションビジネスなんです。
For example, if the customer is managing a factory, we will be providing solutions in terms of how the quality can be improved for products, as well as decreasing or shortening the lead time for a product.
でも現状問題になっているのは何かというと、環境問題、CO2 の削減をどうしないといけないのか、あるいは高齢者社会をどういうふうにして片付けないといけないのかという社会課題、これが今大きな課題になっています。ですから日立はそういう製品を提供する、あるいはお客様との競争で、ソリューションを提供するのに加えて、社会課題を解決していくような、そういう会社に今チェンジしようとしているんですね。
But recently, we are increasingly beset with the social challenges, which is increasing in its importance today, such as environmental problems, CO2emissions, as well as the aging society. Therefore, we will continue to work with the customers in the form of co-creation to develop products.As well as solve the social problems at the same time.
まあそういう会社になるときにですね、現状から未来を想像するというのは、それで見つけていくじゃ難なかなか解決策が出ないです。だから2050年に私たちの社会がどういうふうになるかということをですね、想像して、そしてそれからバックキャストして。課題解決の方法を探るというのが非常に重要です。その一環として京都大学と日立兄弟ラボというのを作って、2050年の世界を今ディスカッションしてですね、何が問題かっていうのを議論したのがクライシス 5.0 なんです。
However, it is very difficult to imagine the future from where we are today. That is the reason why we have set the timeframe of 2050 to imagine the challenges besetting society at that point in time, and then backcast to develop solutions for that time in the future.This is what we are referring to as Crisis 5.0, which is a work that we have conducted with Kyoto University for looking into the society in 2050.
これはですから京都大学との、非常に共通、日立兄弟ラボではですね、その工学系とか医学系とかそういう話じゃなくて、自然科学だけじゃなくて人文科学とか社会科学とかいろんな分野の先生方の状況をお話を聞いて、じゃあ2050年って人間って何がどういう人間の欲望って何だろう、人間はどういうふうな発想になるんだろうみたいなところをディスカッションしてまとめたんです。そうするともうびっくりすることが分かりまして、 クライシス 5.0 という形でまとめました。
With the Kyoto University, we have established what is called the Hitachi University of Kyoto University Lab, which is an interdisciplinary effort involving professors not only in engineering, medical field, but also natural sciences, humanities, as well as social sciences. And together, we have tried to imagine what people's desire and ideas will be in the time of 2050. And we were quite surprised by the results of this endeavor. This is what we have come up with in Crisis 5.0.
どうぞ。そうしますとね、3つのね、大きな課題が出ました。Crisis 5.0 に。一つは、2050年って何を信じたらいいの？信じるものがなくなりました。それから2つ目、頼るもの、誰に頼ったらいいの？それから3つ目、ロボットとか AI とかに置き換わってやることがありません。そういうその3つのトリレンマといってますか、信じるものがなくなる、頼るものがなくなる、やることがなくなる。これが2050年の人間の悩みだというのが出ました。
And through this, endeavor, we have been able to identify what is referred to as the trilemma of besetting human beings in 2050. The first is that people will have nothing to believe in. Second is nothing to rely on. And third is nothing to do with the prevalence of robotics as well as AI.
というのが、まあ、クライシス 5.0 で出されたその3つの大きな問題というのが出てきたわけですね。
So, through the crisis 5.0, we have been able to identify three issues.
それでその後ですね、じゃあそれを解決するにはどうすればいいんだっていう議論を1年近くやりました。
After identifying these challenges, we spent the next one year to develop solutions for these challenges.
ですから AI、ロボット、そういうのがどんどんどんどん進化をして、我々の生活の中2050年入ってくるでしょう。そういって、あるいは2045年シンギュラリティという言葉があって、その AI が人間を追い越しちゃうよみたいな議論がありますけど、まあ、それは私は信じてませんが、実は2050年というのはそういうものすごく AI とかロボットとかそういうのが社会の中でメインになって、本当に人間は何をしたらいいんだろうとか、何を信じればいいんだろうとか、やることは全くないよみたいなことになるだろうというのがまず想像できます。
There is an increasing evolution of the AI and robots toward the time frame of 2050. It is likely to become more prevalent. People talk about the singularity occurring in 2045, which means that AI will at that point in time exceed the ability of human beings. By the way, I don't believe that, but many people are saying so.But it is true that AI and robotics will increasingly become the mainstream in society, and that is when human beings will be beset with the trilemma.
Audrey-san, what are your opinions in hearing
Audrey-san はどのようにお考えで
し
ょうか？今お話ししましたけれど、
on crisis 5.0.Do you sympathize with him in any ways, or do you give us your opinion towards his approach?
どのようなことを考えているか。
I can imagine quite easily. I just imagine myself around 70 years old. And as a 70-year-old person, I think what's important to me.Is whatever that we feel trustworthy today continue to feel trustworthy when I'm 70 years old. This is the conservation of culture, and this is what I mean by plurality as an antidote to singularity. Singularity may be near, but a plurality as here. Should I wait for the consecutive translation? Or is it simultaneous? Or do I just speak on? I'll just go on. Okay, good. So I think the three main ideas that was identified by you, I think it boils down to what could still be trusted that could be continued in the next 30 years. For example, if I still trust myself, if I still trust my autonomy, then a lot of the issues around having no one to rely on is actually not a problem, because something that I participate in could be still trusted. Or I can trust you because you may offer your thoughts in such a transparent manner without requiring me to first join some hierarchy. If you freely share your ideas as our conversation is having now, then this transparency by itself is worthy of trust. So it seems like the core issue of the crisis 5.0 was that at this moment in the society, people had too much reliance on the centralization, on the chiefly curated by a few people structure. And this over-reliance on this top-down structure causes this crisis 5.0. So that's what I would like to contribute and move us away from the center to the edges, because the collective intelligence is at the edges.
私も全く同感です。それでその後に解決策としてイマジネーション 5.0 というのを出したんだけども、そこではね、おっしゃる通り、信頼を得るには参加型にならないと、自分が参加していくということが非常に重要だというのが分かりました。人間参加型社会に、自分が社会をどう変えたいという主体性を持って参加していくということが非常に重要。そのためにはオードリーさんおっしゃられたように、信頼できない、社会を信頼できないといけない。そのためには透明性じゃないといけない。全く それでポイントは、そのさっき言った3つのトリレンマを持った人間が社会を変えていこうという主体的な参画型の人間になっていかないと、これは自分が悩むだけで、悩むだけになってしまうよ。そのためには、オードリーさんがおっしゃられたような信頼というのが非常に重要になります。
I completely agree with what you have said, Audrey-san. And that is the reason why we have been working on Imagine a Nation of 5.0, which is calling for society where it is based on trust. The people must feel that they can change a society with a sense of ownership. In order to have the trust in society, it is necessary to have the transparency. That is of utmost importance. The trilemma will mean that society will have to change, and people must change to become more participatory in a society. Unless you can do that, people will have to struggle. That is the reason why a trust is of utmost importance, as you have said.
それで一つ、私は大通りさんがね、今回のその COVID-19 でやられたような国民との対話、ものすごくオープンで透明性のあることをやられました。それで私はね、それは企業経営にとっても非常に重要な示唆を与えてくれました。企業を改革していくにはトップダウンで大事なんです。CEO 自らが改革をしていくという意思は大事ですが、それがどういうふうに、末端まで一緒に働いている仲間に伝わっているかというのを、こうボトムアップでこう上がってこないと、これは透明性になりません。それと大事なのは、その一人一人、働いている一人一人が、私は社会との関係をどういう形で持って、社会とのですね、自分が日立の仕事を通じて社会にこんな貢献をしてるんだっていう、そういう意思があることが、トップダウン、ボトムアップでこう共有できると、 ものすごくいい会社になるというので、今私はそこにを一生懸命トップダウンとボトムアップのですね、こうバランスを取るというのが、まあ、CEO の大きなミッションとしてやっています。
Audrey さん、I have been very impressed by the national dialogue that you have promoted in an open manner against the backdrop of the COVID-19 in your country. Transparency was of utmost importance in that regard.And I believe that the management of the company must be top down in order to lead the company. However, transparency on the part of the CEO is necessary as well. And this direction must be conveyed to everyone in the company, which requires bottom-up transparency as well.Each and every one of our employees must have a feeling of engagement with a society through Hitachi. This requires both a top-down and bottom-up approach. And I believe that the role of a good CEO is to strike the right balance between the two.
そうですね、今エンゲージメントという話がありますけど、エンゲージメント非常に重要なんです。でかつ、今日本もですね、日立も COVID-19 で、在宅勤務という形になりましてね、在宅で仕事をしているのでちょっとこう、距離があってですね、スキンシップみたいななかなかこう遠くて確認ができないんですけど、まあ、そういった状況の中でも従業員一人一人がやっぱり今日一日の仕事で社会にこんな貢献ができたみたいなことをこう会話でコミュニケーションできると非常にね、私も嬉しいし従業員にとってもやりがいがあると思っています。でそれはどういうことかというと、例えば、日立のは鉄道とかですね、あるいは水事業とか、いろんなこうインフラに関わる仕事をしています。例えば鉄道ですと1年間に185億人の人を延べで、ね、安全に運んでるというそういう車両とか信号システムを提供してたり、水であると1日に7000万人の安心した水を供給してる、それを今日一日の仕事でこんなですね、自分は貢献をしたみたいなことを常に考えながらやると、この非常にやりがい、働き方改革じゃなくて働きがい改革を今エンゲージメントの中で一生懸命やっております。特にこのリモートの仕事の上では重要です。
Engagement is indeed very important because increasingly in Japan as well as in Hitachi, increasing number of employees are now working from home. There is more distance, meaning less skinship. That means that it is important to have all the employees communicate the way they are contributing to society on a daily basis. This will make the employees happy as well as myself very happy as well. Hitachi is engaged in various types of the infrastructure business, such as railway systems as well as the water business. For example, in railways, we are transporting safely with our rolling stock.18 billion people a year. In terms of water, we are providing safe water for 70 million people in the world and on a daily basis. So through this work, I'm sure that employees will have a feeling of truly contributing to society.So I think it's important to, now that more people are working from home, that there is a work, not just a work style reform, but also a sense of satisfaction of working should be enhanced as well.
Audrey-san, what do you think about...Mr. Higashihara's approach of trying to take balance from top down and bottom up, and also his way of cherishing engagement and trying his employees to be connected to society and trying to contribute. What are your feelings towards that?
In traditional workplaces, when we only get to talk to people in the same room or at most over telephone lines, the organization chart could be imagined as a tree. And if it's a tree, of course, there's a top, there's a bottom. But when I talked about moving on from the top to bottom idea, I'm not saying that everything should be grassroots. I'm not saying that things should be bottom up instead of top down. I'm saying maybe we can think differently from this top down narrative, because in a digital world, anyone can connect to anyone. When people are working from home, they may have five windows open. And so what used to be the case where it's only the top leadership in two organizations can talk freely to each other, like you are at the top of your organization chart, and I am, I guess if you look at Taiwan bureaucracy in the central government, I'm somewhere near the top. But in the network world, we're both, instead of at the top, maybe just at the outside of the organization. This is a, I think, Buckminster Fuller idea. If you think about us and its gravity field, what we say down is actually closer to the inside of the earth. And what we say top actually means closer to the outer shell or to the sky or to the space, because the earth is a sphere. There's no direct top or bottom. There's only closer to the outside and closer to the inside. And so through transparency, even though there may be many layers, still people can see the sky from a transparent glass very easily, even with telescope and such. So I think transparency really helps us building not only an open space, but a reflective space where everyone can see what the impact their actions are having on the society. And if this is a positive impact, of course people will believe in what they are working on much more passionately, because they know that they are saving for the planet's future, that they are making 2050 a better time and a better place. And if people are seeing instead that their actions are withdrawing from the accounts of 2050, that we are making the pleasure of this generation at a cost of ourselves in the 70 years old or 30 years down the line, then when that's made accountable and transparent to this generation, people will refrain from doing that, like doing more CO2 emissions and so on. So transparency leads to better accountability and engagement and participation in a way that moves the inside and the outside together.
あのちょっとね、トップダウンとボトムアップという言葉はよくなかったかもしれないけど、あの、おっしゃるように、従業員全員がフラットでネットワークにするということは非常にやっぱり重要だと思います。その、そのためには、共通のポリシーというか共通の考え方を持つ必要があると思います。だからそれがいかにですね、あの、例えば日立の場合であるとですね、あの企業理念が優れた自主技術製品の開発を通じて社会に貢献するという、まあ、社会貢献というのを謳ってます。この、優れた自主技術製品の開発を通してですね、社会に貢献する、この1ワードなんですね。これが全従業員が同じようなまあ、DNA として持って、どんな活動パターンもそのポリシーに従って、あのクレドに従ってやるという、この確信が得れれば完全にトップダウン、ボトムアップという言葉はいらない、ネットワークでいいと思ってます。
Perhaps I should have not used top down and bottom up because I also believe in a flat organization and a network type of organization is very important as well. But in order to enableSuch a process, a common policy and ideas are necessary. In the case of Hitachi, we have the corporate philosophy from our founding, which is to contribute to society through outstanding technologies as well as products. This is the DNA of our employees. And as long as we are guided by this principle, I am convinced that the we can have the appropriate organization, which is neither top down or bottom down.
っと続けていいですか。 Thank you. でそれでオードルさんともちょっとあの後でまた質問したいと思うんですが、私その中でね、人間についてよく考えます。2050年の時の人間の欲望についてよく考えるんだけど、人間っていうのはやはりねエゴイストです。わがままで、これがある限り、まあ、資本主義もそうですけど、資本主義も営利主義なんですよ。ですからあの人間の欲求って言いますか、欲望は消えないと思った方がいい。で大事なことは、私が一番こう人間として大事にしないといけないのは利他の心、あの利する他人って書いて利他です。それで自分だけのことを考えるのを自利と言いましょう。エゴって言います。自利と、これ利他っていうのはアルトゥイズムと言ったり、あのなんだっけセルフレスネスとか言ったりしますけど、この利他の気持ちが私は、最も重要な、あの我々が意識しないといけない。自分の発想は全てエゴです、わがままです。そういう考え方でみんなにこう対応しないといけない。お客様との対応、あるいはそういうことが、それを前提にじゃあウィンウィンの形をどう作っていくのかっていう発想を常に持つということがですね、これは従業員とのエンゲージメントもそうです、お客様との対応もそうだし、あの日立の製品こんないい冷蔵庫ができたのでなんで買ってくれないんですかみたいなことでは、あのお客様とは会話今できませんね。お客様は何を欲しがってるかっていうことを、あの自分の製品を売りたいじゃなくて、そこで、あのお客様の考え方を共有をして、そして次のビジネスだからね、ある意味じゃ利他っていうか、自分の欲望を超えたところの気持ちでですね付き合わないといけない。これ私ね、これが私従業員とのエンゲージメント、お客様との対応、全てに必要なことだと思います。
If I may also continue, I believe that as we have an outlook toward the 2050, we have to not forget the fact that the human beings are inherently has desires. We are egoistic as well as selfish. This is also reflected in the profit-seeking behavior of capitalism as well. And there is no end to the desires of the human beings. But against this backdrop, I am a proponent of altruism, which is sometimes also translated as selflessness, which is in contrast to egoistic or selfish. I think the altruism philosophy is most important for consumers as well. We have to also have this mindset in engaging with the customers as well as our employees. For example, we cannot force a customer to buy a refrigerator that we make just because we think it is good. That is not the approach that is accepted today. Altruism is important to engage with the employees as well as customers.
で、オードリーさんの、いろんな私記事とか本とか読ませていただいて、本当に素晴らしいのはこの利他の気持ちを前面に出して活動されてるんじゃないかなと思ってですね、そのあたりの多分それが信頼を得るための大きなキーワードになるんじゃないかと思うんですけど、オードリーさんのそこのあたりのお考えをぜひ聞きたいなと思います。
オードリーさん、I have read many articles that you have written and also books that you have written as well. And the common theme underlying what you are proposing is altruism. And I believe this is the reason why trust can be gained.What is your view on this?
Yes, I think trustworthiness stems from making everyone understand why it's good for me to do things that's also good for you. This is a very simple idea. For example, I can say I wear a mask for myself because I want to protect my own face against my own unwashed hand. Now, this is entirely selfish, I didn't even talk about other people in this sentence. I only care about my own health, right? I'm wearing a mask, so I don't touch my face with my unwashed hand. But this sentence, if people remember it, if it spreads like a meme, if I wear a mask and tell people, hey, wear a mask so you can protect your own face against your unwashed hand, it turns something that is good for me into something that's good for everybody. And so the trick here is not to say I'm selfless, but rather start with I'm doing this because it's good for me. But if we do this together, it's good for everyone. That's the idea with spreading.
オードリーさんだけじゃなくて、台湾政府の皆さんのアプローチが、この COVID-19 のアプローチを非常に感動したことがございます。日本でもだいぶテレビの放映されましたけど、小学校ですかね、学校に行って男の子がピンクのマスクしかなくて、ピンクのマスクつけたらですね、みんなにからかわれたみたいなことがあったら、その夜の記者会見で担当の方がみんなピンクのマスクつけてですね、対応される。これね、非常に重要で、相手の立場に立って考えられる能力、これリタにとっては非常に相手の立場に立って考え行動できる能力っていうのはね、私は尊敬するんです。で、これはオードリーさんもそうでしょうけど、台湾政府の皆さんがなんかそういう気持ちをお持ちなんじゃないかなと思ってまして、ぜひそのあたりどういうふうにこう周りの方も含めてね、そういう相手の立場を考えられるような組織になってんでしょうっていうのが私の次の質問です。
I saw on the television program about the Taiwanese government's approach as well. There was a little boy that was picked up on because he was wearing a pink mask. And then on that day in the evening, the press conference was held by officials all wearing pink masks. So I think this is very reflective of what I am calling for in terms of altruism. It is necessary for people to be able to empathize and act for others. This is the type of person I can respect. So my question to you is, how can you get the people to share this common empathy?
I think two things are important here. One is that there need to be a space for people to listen deeply to one another, a safe space for such listening. When doing civic infrastructure in the physical world, we understand if you have a park, if you have good design of university settings, a museum maybe, a library, a town hall, maybe a national park, these are the places worth investing taxpayer money too, because it creates a space where people can reflect and listen to people who may seem different, have different positions, but ultimately they arrive at shared common values because of the scenery, because of the music, the nature, the design of such spaces. So we need that also in our digital spaces so we can listen at scale. In addition to a space for listening, I think it's also important to frame the crisis as a common challenge without blaming any particular person or any particular group. If the minister in Taiwan said, oh, we will punish the boys that bully the young boy who wear the pink mask, that will not work. It will only alienate these bullies in the school. It will only create revenge or discrimination. It's like fighting fire with fire. That could not work. Only when we say, oh, our common challenge is actually how can we fight a virus and how can we get 3/4 of people having easy access to masks, only then can we relax from our counter-COVID strict guidelines. And so by framing a challenge as something that everyone can overcome together rather than us versus them or us versus him or her, this makes the empathy possible in such a safe space.
You're great.
Thank you very much. Is the Taiwan government, it has a notion of altruism?
Mm-hmm. Yes, definitely. Yeah, we in our education curriculum, the national curriculum for basic education, we say the three things the student must learn are autonomy, interaction, and the common good. And the common good is, I believe, what you mean by altruism.
はい、今ちょっと課題が見えてきまして、うん、企業のトップの東原さん、あと政府にいらっしゃるオードリーさん、はい、まあ、ちょっと立場は違いますが、まあ、この来るべき2050年の課題に向けてどのように、まあ、アプローチ、まあ、今どのようにアプローチして2人がこう実践されているかっていう、具体的な何か取り組みとかあれば教えていただきたい。
So it seems that there are solutions or the challenges already identified, and Higashihara-san is representing the corporate side. Audrey-san, you are representing the government side. So can you speak specifically about how you are approaching to find solutions for 2050?
私から、じゃあ企業側の私から2050年に向けてどういうことをやろうとしているかといいます。2050年は日本政府も発表しましたけど、カーボンニュートラルにするというやっぱり環境問題が一番大きい問題だと思いますし、と同時に私は3つの価値を高めたいと思います。環境価値の改善、それからこうレジリエンスと言ってますが、日本は災害、地震とか災害とかインフラの強靭化みたいなことが今うたわれ、だんだんだんだんこう老朽化しますから、このそういうレジリエンスの価値を提供する、当然サプライチェーンのこうレジリエンスも必要です。そういう、それから最後に安全安心、 COVID も一つですけど、ヘルスケア、これがヘルスケアが非常に重要だと思っています。ですから3つの社会的課題って何かというと、その環境、レジリエンス、安全安心、ヘルスケア含めた安全安心、この3つの価値を高めるために我々は何ができるんだろうっていうのを例えば今進めています。2050年にはこういった社会課題が非常に大きな問題になるというふうに考えています。
Well, on the part of the corporate side, let me answer this question. I believe that the environmental challenges will become increasingly important as we move toward 2050. Japanese government has also set forth with a target of carbon neutrality as well. There are three environmental values that are very important. First is resilience. We are prone to natural disasters, therefore resilience must be enhanced. Also, our infrastructure are increasingly becoming old, therefore they must be improved going forward. And also, safe and secure environment must be established, especially in the advent of the COVID-19, inclusive of the better healthcare.So, three specific areas will be our focus, environmental, enhancing resilience, as well as providing safe and security, inclusive of the health, and because these are becoming increasingly important in 2050.
例えば環境問題についてこの 5,6 年先の話まで今何やってるか言いますと、例えば鉄道事業がございますけど、鉄道のはまあ架線があって電気で走ってるところはいいんですけど、架線がないところに電池ですね、バッテリーを入れて、架線のあるところで充電をして、架線がないところはその電気で走るみたいな、今それがディーゼルであったり CO2 を排出するようなのをですね、こうハイブリッドの車に変えていったりですね、そのうち水素で動く車に電車になってくると思います。それがそういうこと、あるいは我々としたらもう一つ自動車業界、これが EV 車に変わっていきますから、 EV のに関連する部品提供は日立がやっぱりナンバーワンで提供したいと思ってて、モーターとかインバーターとかサスペンションとかブレーキ、これは 車が EV になっても必要な部品ですので、まあ、それはEV 電気自動車を作るのをもっと何ですか、作りやすくできるような部品を提供するというのが2つ目のアプローチ。3つ目は、パワーグリッド、電気をこう送るパワーグリッドを今 ABB と日立でジョイントメンチャー作りましたけど、そういったパワーグリッド、電気をこう運ぶということに対して、直流送電の技術とか、要は CO2 を出さないような CO2 といいますか、電装ロスをゼロにする、ミニマムにするような、パワーグリッドのシステム、今はこれは風力発電の場所から直流送電で陸地使うところに送るみたいなところで世界中で今展開してますけど、まあ、そういう、環境に関する事業を今一生懸命やってますと同時に、環境問題は2050年というとまだ先もあるので、今基礎研究を相当やらないといけないと思ってます。もっともっとカーボンニュートラルに貢献できる、例えば CO2 をダイレクトキャッチする技術とか、人工光合成みたいな、いろんなこう基礎要素があるんです。これまだまだ先のお話です。あるいはエネルギーを蓄えておく技術みたいな、そういうのは、今から30年先を見据えて基礎研究の段階で、やっていきたいと思う。だからここ5年から10年できることと、2050年に向けて長期で基礎研究から始めないといけない、2つに分けて環境問題を取り組んでいます。
Let me speak a little bit more about the environmental initiatives that we are implementing in the 5 to 6 year timeframe. In the railway system, when there is electricity, there is no problem, but there are areas where electricity cannot be provided. So we are able to utilize electricity storage to enable the railway network, even for diesel as well. There will be increasing use of the electric vehicles as well as hydrogen used as fuel as well. In the area of automobiles, with the prevalence of electric vehicles, we want to be the number one parts provider for electric vehicles, whether it be motors, inverters, suspensions, brakes, which will be required even for electric vehicles. Also power grid is an area of focus for us as well. We have a joint venture with the ABB, a direct current transmission will mean less loss in terms of the transmission of electricity. We can also have a direct current transmission of electricity globally from areas of the wind power generation as well. Environmental issue does not stop at the 2050. This will be a continuous process. And that is the reason why basic research is very important. Some basic research we are conducting is CO2 direct capture, as well as artificial photosynthesis as well. So we have to not only think of the 2050 timeframe, but also in stages.
でもう一つ、オードリーさんは IT のプロフェッショナルというかデジタルのプロフェッショナルですけど、今デジタルと社会インフラをこうつないでですね、より高度なインテリジェントな社会インフラを提供するということも今始めています。まあ、環境で申し上げますとですね、まあ、コペンハーゲンの地下鉄っていうのは今日立は何ですかね、ドライバーレスで24時間無人運転の電車を走らせています。これ車両も信号システムも全て入れてますけども、と同時に最近はですね、プラットフォーム、駅のプラットフォームにどのくらいの人が待ってるのかっていうのをセンサーで上げて、その待ってる乗客のに合わせてダイアグラムをコントロールするという、その、ダイナミックヘッドウェイというシステムを今検証してます。これはなぜかというと、コペンハーゲンはですね、メッセとかいろんなイベントがあると乗客の数がこんなに変動するので、そういう意味で、たくさんいるときは極力待ち時間を少なくする意味でたくさんの電車を走らせて、あまり人がいないときにはもうちょっと間隔を空けて、 絶対的なあの電車 の, 本あのダイヤはあの環境のことを考えながら極力抑えるみたいな、それと CO2 の排出は収まるし、待っている乗客の人はですね、あの平均の待ち時間が少なくて済みますよね。そういうことをデジタルとあのインフラ提供技術でこう組み合わせて、実践あの環境にも優しい、人にも優しいシステムを提供しているというのも一つの対応です。
Audrey-san, you are world-renowned digital professional, and Hitachi is also in utilizing the power of the digital to improve the social infrastructure today. For example, in the area of the environment, I would like to give you the example of the subway system in Copenhagen. We are now operating 24 hours driverless subway operation in Copenhagen, inclusive of the rolling stock as well as the signaling system. We also have sensors that have been installed in the, on the platform of the station to monitor the traffic at the station so that it can be reflected in the train operation schedule. It's called dynamic headway. Because Copenhagen is a city where traffic can increase or decrease very dramatically depending on the events that are taking place. And with this system, we are able to operate less, more trains when there is more traffic and less trains when there is less traffic. By so doing, we can also reduce the CO2 emissions and reduce the waiting time for the people waiting for the trains. This is good for environment people as well.
Audrey-san, Hitachi's approach in environment, resilience, and healthcare.
Resilience,
And also, they are really focusing on digital infrastructure. As digital minister of Taiwan, do you have any perspective to add to that? What kind of approach do you have to solve future issues?
Well, the camera currently doesn't capture it, but I'm wearing the same pin as you do. So we do have the shared values, and that's sustainability. I often say IT connects machine to machine, but digital connects people to people. And so to develop, say, AI in a way that connects people to people speaks to the untapped potential of collaboration between diverse sets of people for long-term benefit. If we develop AI for the short-term thinking, we will be focusing on replacing human beings in the individual work. But if we set our eyes in the long term, naturally, we will enable the kind of collaboration, human to human, human to machines, that was unimaginable before the advent of AI technologies. So I totally agree that a long-term view is the crux of the problem here, and we need to think beyond the short-term profit and loss, but rather on the right and wrong to the five generation, seven generations down the line, at least starting from the 2050 thinking, so that we are all better ancestors by developing AI.
開発はやってまして、今あの人の幸福をですね、測定する AI って言いますか、まあ今回去年の7月に独立したあのハピネスプラネットという会社も作りましたけど、それどういうことかというと、人間のこの動きをですね、ビッグデータの解析をして、この人は非常に何ですかね、ハピーなのかアンハピーなのかをこう、まあ、一つは加速度センサーみたいなのことで測定をするという技術をだいぶ蓄積してきました。
Hitachi has also been working on AI in development as well. We are trying to measure the happiness of people using AI. We have an organization called the Happiness Planet, which was launched, which became independent in April of last year. We are utilizing the power of analysis of big data to measure the happiness of people, whether they are happy or unhappy, utilizing sensors.
そう、先ほどあの従業員とのコミュニケーションという話が出ましたけど、みんなそういう今はスマホの中にそのソフトを入れて、みんなこうスマホを持ってるとですね、そのハピネス度合いを測定できるんですね。ですから私あの今リモートワークがどんどん進んでますから、自分のグループのチームのメンバーにハピネス度合いを測定してもらって、それで、どういう時にハピネス度合いが上がって、どういう時に下がって、結局チームのアウトプットがそのハプネス度合いによってあの変化しますから、それをあのプロジェクトのリーダーは常にどういう時にあの意識したらいいのかっていうのを今調べたりしています。でリモートワークの時のポイントはね、3つあるみたいなことを今そこのトップ矢野っていう CEO がいるんですけど、それと議論をして、リモートワークの時に、大事なのはこう離れてますから、今3密って悪のように言われますけど、一番いいコミュニケーションの手段が3密、あの非常にあの、同じ部屋であの密になって会話をするみたいなのが非常にいいんだけど、それをそのリモートでできないのかっていうので、あの一つあります。リモートでやるとどういうことかというと、お話した時にこうなずくとか、この反応するというのは一つですね。それで、一人が全部喋らない、メンバー全員にこう喋ってもらったり参加させるみたいなこと、それから、定期的にあの朝あのミーティングして、あの夜まであの仕事の終わりまで何も話さないんじゃなくて、定期的にこう会話をするとかお話しするみたいな、こうコミュニケーションの密にするっていうか、この3つぐらいをやるとね、非常にリモートワークも非常にあの親近感が覚えられて、いいあのリモートワークのチームができるみたいなことを今あのだいぶ勉強してきました。
Happiness of our employees should be measured as we are now in a working from home environment as well. And because we are now able to measure the happiness of our employees by utilizing the smartphones that they carry. And because the output of working from home will change depending on the happiness of the employees, project leaders must be focused on the well-being of their team. And this has been led by the CEO of the company that I referred to, Mr. Yano. And he told me that there are important factors to bear in mind when working from home. Obviously, we have distance and we have to be careful about the three C's. But in fact, the three C's is the best way to communicate. Inherently, and we are trying to reproduce the 3C environment in the remote environment as well. So, for example, when people are talking, we have to make sure that the people are nodding or responding to people's conversation. And also, it is important for everyone to participate, not just one person. I mean, so that can also be monitored.And there should be regular dialogue, and not just talking during the day and not until night. So by reproducing the 3C environment in the remote working from home environment, we can improve working style altogether overall.
幸せっていう、まあ、お話が出たんですけど、はい、多分その企業活動とか、はい、あとまあそういうソーシャルイノベーションでしたり、まあ、そういう環境問題とかって、まあ、なんで解決するかって結局一人一人がやっぱり幸せに生きるためで、まあ、お二人もきっと多分、まあ、誰も取り残さないつもりになんかそういった社会を作っていきたいのかなと思ってるんですけど、でちょっとまずあの、まあ、タンさんにまずお伺いしたいんですけど、まあ、タンさんがその幸せをなんかどんなふうに考えていらっしゃるか、
る、
まあ、捉えているかっていうところをお伺いしても。
I think happiness is the key word. This is very important for companies as well as in the area of social innovation. Happiness, meaning leaving no one behind, is what we have to aim to achieve. So, Tan-san, what is your view on what are your thoughts on happiness?
I think there needs to be happiness at all different time scales. On the short time scale, it's fun. Like sharing the Shiba Inu picture is fun. On the terms of a couple of days, the fun also spreads to other people, like the pink mask story, it's also fun. But in the longer term, I think the digital realm also calls for joy or enjoyment. I think that corresponds to the creativity part in a 3C work environment. Only when we create something together do we feel the true enjoyment of making the world better for everyone. So we're not just consuming funny pictures, dog or cat pictures, but rather participating in the creation of culture. Now, moving beyond the time scale of enjoyment, what I also want to say is a feeling of what the Greek call eudaimonia. And eudaimonia is this well-being fulfilled to a point where everyone become flourishing and capable of sharing spontaneously in the mood of altruism toward the common good. And that's something we should strive toward. So I think we can, of course, measure happiness or well-being on a moment-to-moment basis, but also a long-term view is also needed so that we can flourish toward eudaimonia through enjoyment.
みんなが幸せになるってのは非常にいい言葉ですね。で、幸せっていうのは他人にね、こう例えば与えて減るもんじゃなくて、かえって増えちゃう、増えるもんなんですね。だからみんなで幸せになるというような気持ちが、もう日本だと国民、あるいは、我々人たちだと従業員全員がみんなが幸せになるということで、気持ちが一致すればものすごくね、その会社も組織、国も非常に素晴らしいなんていうかコミュニティになると思いますね。
I think your thoughts on having happiness for everyone is extremely good, because happiness does not decrease because you give to someone. If anything, it increases by giving to others. And this should be felt by the citizens of Japan as well as Hitachi employees. And if we are able to have this common understanding, I think it would improve to make a better community for the company, organization, as well as a country.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I totally agree, which is why I like your slogan about social innovation to power the good, right? Powering good, because the common good is very powerful.
Power good together. Let's yes. Power good together.
Power good together, yes.
Thank you.
I think the keyword here is really happy employees, happy people. And I'd like to turn this interview into the next phase in how to cultivate leaders who are happy and who have the skills and the quality of like changing and building a sustainable future. Can you talk about your ideas on what kind of personnel is required? To Audrey-san.
I think what we are doing in Taiwan is we're empowering the power of creating common good even before they become voters, even before the age of 18. We firmly believe that starting young, the younger generation have an inherent better grasp of what a far future would be like, because they will be around for longer and they care about a longer term future. We see the 17 years olds and the 70 years olds, the two age groups on the both sides of the population demographics, care the most about environmental sustainability and the common good in our digital democracy platforms. And I think because of that, we need to design an area where anyone, they may be just 15, 13, 12, and they can set the agenda, the direction for the entire country. And in our digital democracy platform, more than one quarter of citizens' initiatives, for example, about banning plastic straws from bubble tea takeouts and so on, all started by people younger than 18. And when they feel that they can set an agenda for the entire country, they will become natural leaders. Expect them to be leaders and they will lead the country. If we keep telling them, hey, you're just a young person, wait until you're 50 or 60 or something, then they will not become the natural leaders, even if they have such capability. So empowering them as early as possible is what we're doing in Taiwan.
そういうことでは、私2つまず申し上げたいのは、社会課題とかさっきの環境問題とかインフラのレジリエンスの問題とかあるいはエイジングソサエティの問題、これをね、自分ならどう解決するっていう自分ごとで課題を考えるっていうのが一番大事で、二つ目に自分一人では解決できないのでみんなをこう巻き込むっていうか人をこうインクルードして集めて、一緒に考えようよというような方そういう能力、まずこれが非常に重要じゃないかなと思います。
Yes. Whether it be problems in society or challenges in the environment and infrastructure resilience and aging population issue, what is important is for people to have a sense of ownership of these challenges.And after that, be able to mobilize others, engage others to include them in this effort so that the people can work together in resolving these challenges.
Mm-hmm. Yes, totally agree. Our slogan in social innovation in Taiwan calls for everyone's business with everyone's help. I believe it's saying the same thing.
は関係ないと思います。年齢は関係なくて、自分ごとで考えるのが重要です。それともう一つこれ大事なことはね、未来をどうやって予測するかっていうのは、これもっと早い若い時にですね、考える訓練をつけた方がいいと思います。で、どういうことかというと、私はよく今考えてるのは3つの軸って言いますか、時間軸と地域の軸と価値、人間さっき欲望の塊とか言いますけど、この3つの軸で時代がどう変わっていくのかっていうのを予測するような訓練をやられたらいいと思うんだけど、これ一つ経営学だとペスト分析みたいなのがありますね。ポリティックス、エコノミー、それからソサエティ、テクノロジー、この4つで今5年後、10年後、20年後っていうふうな、こういう時間軸でどう変わっていくのかっていうのをこう見ていく訓練、それで地域によっても違います、日本ではどうだとか、他の、地域ではどうだ、台湾ではどうだとか、インドではどうだって、こう地域で、それは価値がどういうふうに変わっていくのかっていう、そういうね、訓練をつけるっていうのが、私は未来を予測する、なんかこう、いろんな考えがやり方があると思うんだけど、未来を自分で考えてみるっていうね、こうトレーニングみたいなのが重要じゃないかなと思います。
I don't think there is any difference between age in working together. However, it is very important to have young people engage in the process of forecasting the future. That is of the utmost importance. And I am looking at this initiative in terms of the axes of time, region, as well as values, inclusive of the desires human beings have. And in this regard, it is necessary to train the young people how to forecast the future age. People talk about the past analysis, politics, economy, society is very important in the time frame of 5, 10, or 15 years. And also looking at the changes in the values in different regions, such as Taiwan, as well as India. Increasingly, I think it's going to be very important to train young people to forecast the future.
それとね、もう2つ目に大事なのは、若い人に期待することになっちゃったけど、2つ目はね、歴史を学んでほしいの。歴史って非常に重要で、将来起こるですね、こう類似ケースが、類似なことが過去に起きてるんですね。それをどういうふうにして、何が原因で起きて、どういう対応をしたかっていうのは、歴史に学ぶっていうことが一つ重要だと思います。で、二つ目に学ぶことはね、なんかモデルっていうか、一番いいのは私、人間の体がよく成功にできているので、人間の体がどうなってるのかを勉強する。例えばさっきおっしゃられたネットワークの話を主張されたけど、人間の脳が全ての細胞に指令を与えているんではなくて、重要な器官ごとのこのオーガンの方のメッセージパッシングをしているエクソソームっていうメッセージパッシングがあって、必ずしも脳からこう指令が出てるわけじゃないみたいなことが今人体のあれで分かってきましたけど、これってデータを一箇所に集めるんではなくて、分散型ネットワーク型の非常にいいビジネスモデルになるんですね。そういうふうに、人間の体とかあるいは社会システムもそうだけど、そういうアナロジー類似性、で物事を考えるっていうのは重要じゃないかなと。2つ目、歴史プラスこれね、類似性。
Now, another point I would like to mention is that it's important to learn from history because what is going to occur in the future has already occurred in the past, and we can find lessons from the past and find the solutions on why the problem has occurred and how it has occurred. It's very important to learn from the past in that regard.And in terms of learning, I think it's also very important to learn about the human body. It can tell us a lot because, after all, human body is a masterpiece. And there's so much that we can learn from it. Now people are saying that in terms of the human body network, instructions are not always given by the brain. Exosomes are said to fulfill a very important role in terms of the message passing of the organs. So there is much more that we can learn. So learn from history as learn from analogy. Looking at the similarities from the past can also be very helpful.
私若い頃にオードリーさんはIT のデジタルのプロフェッショナルだけど、私も一応コンピューターをかじったことがあって、その時にその類似性、どんなことで類似性を考えていくかというと、例えば家にいてこう本を読んでいます。それ で電話がスマホの電話が鳴りました。ここまで読んだっていうしおりでこう置いて、もしもしと電話出ますよね。で終わるとまた本に戻るじゃないですか。で本を読んでるうちにピンポンって宅配便ですみたいな、誰かデリバリーが来た。そうするとまた本を置いてデリバリーに対応して終わると。これ、私の勉強した時代はですね、本能今型コンピューターというコンピューターなので、割り込み処理、何を優先するかと、優先処理っていうのが我々の社会生活の中に全部入ってるんですね。だそういうね、類似性を勉強することによって何ができるかというと、じゃあこのもっと本を読みたいんだけど、お昼が来たからなんかお腹空いたな、なんか買ってきたいけど、自分が行ったら本読めないじゃない。そうすると誰かに、あ、彼2時ぐらいに友達が来るみたいなこと言ったから、お弁当買ってきてくれますかってコンビニからそれを頼むでしょ。でそれははっきり言ってコンピューターの中ではアウトソーシングをしてるわけで、例えばプリンターサーバーにこんだけプリントしてちょうだいとお願いしてるのと同じだから、処理性を上げるには誰かに頼むというのが大事。これは社会、我々の生活の中が一つのアナロジー類似性になっていて、コンピューターのアルゴリズムってそういう形でできていくんですね。だからそういうね、さっき歴史を学びなさいとかいろいろ言いましたけど、体の身体、体の中を勉強しなさいとか、家庭生活っていうか今の生活を勉強しなさいと言いましたけど、 やっぱり物事を解決していくソリューションというか、そのアイデアがね散らばってんですね。だそれをぜひ若いうちからそういう訓練をつけてもらえるといいなと思いますね。
You are very famous as a digital expert, Audrey San, but I happen to have a background in computer science as well in my young times, in my young days. And similarity is something that is very much reflected in computer science as well. For example, if I am reading a book and the courier service comes to deliver a product, then I would put the bookmark there.And then fetch the good from the courier service. And this is very much, and it can be repeated if another courier service arrives. So this is very much like the interruption process in computer processing as well. Another example is that if it's lunchtime, I would get hungry.And if I know that a friend is coming to visit me at 2 o'clock, and I can ask him to go to the convenience store and bring me a lunchbox. This is outsourcing in the world of computer science. It's like requesting the printer service, the server to print later. There is so much to relearn from similarities in this regard because algorithms in computers have been developed following such thought. So what I want to emphasize is that we must learn from history, from our human body, as well as from lives, because ideas and solutions are all around us. It's everywhere around us, and I would like to encourage this, especially for young people.
How do you think of Mr. Higashihara's idea of seeing all these similarities?
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. Yeah, I think what you just described is what we call computational thinking, thinking about issues from a viewpoint of making sure that a lot of people or a lot of machines can work on it together, right? So this connectedness is inherent in computational thinking. We don't have to solve all the problem by just ourselves. We can work in a way that is orchestrated or decentralized or like a swarm, but collaboration is still of the essence. I would also like to agree on the view on history. I do believe that if people understand the shared histories that we all have, like as Homo sapiens, tracing all the way back, I guess, to East Africa, and the common lineage and culture that has sprouted along the way, then indeed we will find the common metaphors, such as the idea of intersectionality, very hard to explore or even explain, but using the ancient African philosophical idea of Ubuntu, suddenly it become very easy to say, oh, I become a complete person because I help the society complete itself, viewing from my unique piece of puzzle angle to the society. This is very complex concept, but just the word Ubuntu summons this common heritage that we all share as part of the human community. So I do believe history informs our common future as well, and understanding the common history will free us from the temporal us versus them thinking that divides the human population around different ideologies. And only then is human-centeredness possible. Because if the human community is fragmented, human-centeredness is very difficult.
そうですね、本当にさっきみんなが幸せになるというこう一言で全てを言い表してるんだけど、そんな社会をね2050年にはぜひ作りたいですね。でそのためにはね、やっぱり参加型、自分ごととして社会の中に参加する、一人じゃなくてみんなが参加してどうすれば幸せになるんだとみんなで考える、そんな社会にしないといけないなと思いますね。
Yes, I think what you said earlier about everybody being happy is the most important objective that we have to achieve. That is the type of world we hope to see in 2050. And this will be a society where it is participatory by everyone, not just one person, so that true happiness can be shared.
で企業経営っていうのは今どうもだいぶ変わってきててね、今まではストックホルダーキャピタリズムといったのがステークホルダーキャピタリズムにだいぶ変わってきましたよね。そういうことで、企業の社会の中での企業価値っていうのを単にあの 経済面 あのフィナンシャルのフィギュアだけじゃなくて、やっぱりソーシャルバリューとかエンバイロメンタルバリューとかフィナンシャルバリューっていう、そういうもっとあのなんていうのかな、経済指標だけじゃなくて、こうまさに SDGs 指標とか ESG 指標みたいなやつがもっとやっぱりあの企業を評価するあの指標になっていけばですね、あのその社会を良くするというか幸せにするのに貢献している会社はもっとこう価値が高くなるような、もっと元気が出てくるんじゃないかと思うんだけど、今どうもやっぱりフィナンシャル指標だけが走ってるんでね、そこはやっぱり変えていく必要があると思いますね。
From the point of view of the corporate management, I am happy that we are now moving toward the stakeholder capitalism rather than stockholder capitalism. And because the corporations are part of the society. And however, there is a significant emphasis placed on financial value rather than social value and environmental value. And I believe that as an evaluation metric, SDG and ESG are becoming increasingly important. So I hope that companies will be evaluated based on how much contribution is made toward the enhancement of the happiness, and the value will increase accordingly. That will be very much encouraging for companies going forward. I think today there is too much emphasis placed on financial value.
人のつながりをなんかどうやってつなげていくか、あのこれからのリーダーがどうやってつなげていけばいいのかということをあのお伺いしたいんですけど、例えば歴史とかその未来を学ぶことで、まあ、何が見つかるかというと共通の価値、あの炭素の言葉を借りれば、まあ、そこを共通の価値をどうつなげていくかというのが、まあ、多分次世代のリーダーに一つ求められるところなのかなと思うんですけど、まあ、それで炭素はご自身 その転訳者みたいなことを自分のことを表現されたりしてますけど、
ね、
なんかまあそこでなんか大切なこととかって何かあるかちょっとお伺いしてもよろしいでしょうか。
何学者っておっしゃいますか。
転訳者。
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 転訳者って何。
あ、タンさんがご自身表現されて、すみません。
転訳者って日本語で分かるんですか。
はい、あ、分かると思います。
はい、分かります。So, I have a question for Tan-san. I think the bond between people will become very important in the future as we learn from the past as well. And what is going to bond us will be common values. That will be very important. And Tan-san, you are a proponent of 転訳者. Do you know that?What is your thought on that? What are the common values to bond people together?
Yes. So actually, the talk about stakeholder capitalism, about a social solidarity-based economy that you just mentioned, is the founding principle.Of the current government in Taiwan, which I translate the name of the state as a transcultural republic of citizens. And according to these ideas, which are more than 110 years ago now, actually roughly the same age as your company, and these ideas makes sure that people develop their individual good.But always within a mechanism, within a social design that empowers the common good by propelling each contributor to reveal as much as possible transparently how their actions help or hurt the others. And this is where digital can really help, because previously accountability, as evidenced by auditors or accountants and so on, is very expensive, both in time as well as in financial resources. But nowadays, with the assistive intelligence or the Internet of Beings and so on, accountability and transparency is in the flow of work. Or this very conversation, I'm recording it, I'm publishing it to YouTube. And so this doesn't cost us any extra time or effort to make our conversation transparent and inclusive of future generations. So I think the main idea here is just reduce the friction, reduce the cost of time, reduce the risk of being transparent and inclusive, and people will naturally behave in such a way.
あの非常に重要で、仲間をこう作るっていうのは、まあ、デジタルでいろいろ SNS も含めて仲間作れますけど、大事なことは自分がやっぱりそういうさっきの利他の気持ちじゃないけど、みんなと幸せになるっていうのをどんどんどんどん出していく、でそれに共感した人が加わっていくみたいなことが非常に重要で、いつもこの相手が自分がやっても相手が見返りを期待するっていうのかな、相手がこんなことしてくれるだろうみたいなことを期待するようでは、多分そういう社会はできなくて、どんどんどんどん自分はもう社会に貢献するって、そういうことをやって仲間も巻き込んでいくみたいな、そんな社会づくりにしないと、多分人間ってベースはわがままなのでなかなかね難しい。でもね、日本語、これ日本の言葉に情けは人のためならずって言葉あるんだけど、相手に何かをこうする見返りを求めるんじゃなくて、やがてそれは自分に返ってくるっていう言葉ありますよね。情けは人のためならず、本当にみんなそれを信じて、社会に自分は何ができるんだろうというふうにやってもらえるような社会をどうやって作っていくかがね、やっぱりこれからの、まあ、日本もそうですけど、世界を良くする非常に重要なね、アプローチになるんじゃないかと思います。
So, I think digital technologies can be powerful in enhancing your friends, to increase the number of friends. That is possible. However, altruism is again very important, and it's important for one to take the initiative to give first so that others can join. You cannot do something by expecting something in return. That is not the approach of, appropriate approach. So to give and to contribute on one's initiative, and to mobilize others to join is what must be achieved. In Japanese, people say that the compassion is not for oneself, it is for others. So I think this type of approach of giving and contributing with one's initiative should be expanded globally.
うん、でもそれでね、 AI を開発するんだけど、 AI はねやっぱり倫理観っていうのは非常に重要だと思います。倫理観、それで日立は最近ね AI の倫理原則っていうのを作りました。でやっぱり人間のために AI を社会実装するとか、人間のために AI を開発して利活用するとか、人間中心の社会のために AI を使うんだっていうのを徹底するような原則を作ったんですね。それから AI っていうのはやっぱりそれをずっと一回開発すると維持して メンテナンスまで含めてこれをやるというふうに決めまして、やはりプライバシーの保護とかですね、まあ、いろんなことをもう3つの基準と実践項目は7つの実践項目を決めて、まあ、従業員に AI 開発の徹底をさせてするように言ってあるんだけど、これやっぱりオードリーさんのAI を開発するときの倫理観をどういうことに注意すればいいのかだけをちょっとお聞きしたいなと思います。
So I have a question for you, Audrey-san. It is regarding ethics in the development of AI. We have developed our Hitachi AI ethics principles because we believe the AI development should be human-centric in its social implementation. And that is how AI should be developed and be utilized going forward. And the developed AI must also be maintained as well. And in the we have set forth the three basic principles as well as seven practical items to follow in AI development. What is your view? What are your thoughts in terms of ethics in AI? Audrey-san.
I think the standards of conduct is very well put, and the seven principles do address the majority of the three core principles. However, I must also say that the idea about engagement, about anyone affected being able to participate actively in the use or reuse or remix of such AI technologies is only seen in the three principles, but nowhere to be seen in the seven implementation details. So maybe that is one point that one can consider some conversations around, because the seven principles are made from the point of a operational technologist, someone who runs the AI models for the society. And so it stops at being able to explain to the society, but how to take the input from the society back in, that's in the three pillars, but not in the seven principles. That may be something worth having a future discussion about.
ときちっとこう人間中心の項目が7つの中にも入っているんだけど、ちょっと私が説明しなかったので。
In fact, I did not fully explain this point, but the human-centric ideals are also reflected in the seven implementation principles as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I understand. I'm just talking about the fourth of the seven.Which talks about that Hitachi will continue to check for the change in operation conditions, the people, the mindset in relation to AI and condition in society and so on. And that seems to be an operator's point of view. But what I was referring to is something that empowers the individual users to be not just user, but more like prosumers that can create new things based on the toolkit that's provided by Hitachi and eventually become your co-creators. That co-creation spirit is in the preambles, but not specifically spelled out in point 4 of 7.
こ う, うまくね、今原則を、まあ、作りましたけど、これはやっぱり時間軸でも変わっていくし、社会とのこの関係の中でこれ常に見直していかないといけない項目だと思います。それは分かりました。
Your point is well taken, because although we have developed the principles, it is subject to change going forward, depending on the time frame as well as the conditions prevailing in society.
すみません、もう本当時間がないので最後の質問なんですけれども、Audrey さん、it's the last question, but in discussing about 250.And sharing your approaches. What are your expectations towards Hitachi? Hitachi
does
that. Well, my wish for your organization, which I just checked, is a little bit older, 1 year or two older even to this country, right? Because it's established in 1910 or before 1910, and this country is only in 1912. So usually I say live long and prosper, but because you represent an even longer-lived organization, I'll just say peace and long life.
私2050年っていうのは、今から何年後だ2050年って私何歳になるんだ、95歳かな多分95歳になりますから、大鳥さん70とか言ってたけど、私は95歳になって多分100歳までは行きたいと思いますから日立もね、私のイメージ2050年にはもう社会貢献をするねナンバーワンの会社だみたいなことにしたいなと思います。本当にそういう人々を幸せに、社会を良くして人々を幸せにするね会社っていうと日立だと言われるように頑張ります。
So you, I'm just thinking about my age when 2050 comes. You said you're going to be 70, but I'm going to be 95. But I'm determined to live beyond 100. And at that time, what I'm aiming for is for Hitachi to become the number one company in terms of making contribution to society.To make people happy and a better society. When people talk about these attributes, I want people to think of Hitachi. And I will do my utmost to contribute to this objective.
That's excellent. And thank you for this opportunity for a conversation. I really look forward to meet you face to face after the pandemic is over.
はい、Thank you very much for your taking your time.
最後、カメラに向かってちょっと撮影だけ2人、
はい、どうぞ。はい、
so, there is going to be...
どうすんの、
okay. So there is going to be a photo taken, Audrey-san.
どうすれば、はい、
We are setting up for the photo shoot.
Okay. Oh, patch. Here.
Yes. Yes.
カメラが。ご本人がカメラに映ってツーショットを
どうするこういうことですか。
それでやります。
はい。これでいい？
はい。ちょっとお待ちください。ちょっと近づきすぎちゃいました。申し訳ありません。よし、参りましょう。で、カメラに向かってポーズをぜひ手の動きでも少し入るといいです。
僕もこれしようか。これ出そうか。あ、これだ。何やねんこれ。これでいいんじゃん。
一緒ですか。
いやいや、これで同じんでいい。
じゃあカメラ目線で。
ジャスト・ア・モーメント。ピッ。これですか。
にこやかな感じです。
Please smile.
Good.
OK でしょ。
OK。